able to see the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. All right. So we are going to talk about the heart. Yes, heart is very, very important organ for all of us, right? But today we are not going to deal with the emotional aspect of the heart, but with the electrical activity of the heart, right? So in the class, I think you have discussed about ECG theoretically, right? Today also practical class, but it will be again kind of theory only. Okay, so whenever we talk about terms, we should be clear of that is electrocardiograph and electrocardiogram. So electrocardiograph, though it sounds like a graphical representation, but it is not the graphical representation, but it is the machine which is used to record the ECG patterns. Okay, so whenever we talk about electrocardiograph, it is the machine which is used to record the ECG patterns, okay? And electrocardiogram is a graphic record of the bioelectrical potential originating and spreading over the cardiac musculature during the course of cardiac cycle. Or in a very simple way, you could just can say that electrocardiogram is the graphical representation of the electrical activity of the heart, right? So electrocardiograph is the machine used to record the ECG patterns, and electrocardiogram is the graphical representation of the electrical activity of the heart. Now let us see the procedure, how we gonna record the ECG, right? So for recording ECG, we need certain instruments, right? And they are ECG machine, we need cardiac jelly, we need ECG paper, and we need ECG leads, right? So whenever we talk about electrical activity, so we all know that the electrical activity in the heart, it will precede the mechanical events in a cardiac cycle. That means there will be electrical activity in the heart, then it will be followed by the mechanical activity, right? So those electrical activity before mechanical events occur, that electrical activity will be recorded by the ECG machine. So what principle this ECG machine works on? We know that our body is a volume conductor, that is, body fluids are good conductor of electricity, right? So therefore, electrical changes occurring in the heart with each heartbeat, they are conducted all over the body, right? And these electrical activity, they will be picked up from the body surface by the help of leads, right? So whatever electrical activity occurring in the heart, they will be conducted all over the body. And we are placing leads in certain areas of the body. These leads will pick up the electrical activity by the help of these leads, right? So the requirements, as I told you, we have ECG machine. So you can see in the picture over here, the ECG machine over here, right? Now this ECG machine, they are transistor amplifier, and they have this paper over here. And this ECG machine, it has a main switch which has to regulate the power supply. Then it has a lead selection switch which helps to choose particular leads. So it is not that when you on this ECG machine, you have to take all the graphical representation in all over the leads. No, if you want a particular lead ECG, then we can just choose that particular lead and we can take out the ECG graph, right? Then we have the switch in this ECG machine, which help to regulate the paper speed. Okay, so this is the machine. Then we have cardiac jelly. Well, this cardiac jelly, it is actually made up of paste that contain fine sand or glass particles for placing electrodes on the body surface. Okay, so we use this cardiac jelly on the place where we are going to apply the leads, right? And this lead or this cardiac jelly will help to establish proper contact of the electrode plate to the body, right? So this cardiac jelly function is to establish a proper contact between the electrodes to the body, right? Then we have ECG paper. So you can see the ECG paper over here, right? The ECG machine. This strip of graph paper, which has a vertical and the horizontal lines, which are 1 millimeter apart. So you can see this ECG paper in a little bit zoom. So you can see over here that it has horizontal lines and the vertical lines. They are 1 millimeter apart. It's a small box over here, right? Now this horizontal lines, it represents the time. The horizontal lines, it represents the time. Whereas the vertical lines, it will represent the amplitude. Okay, so in ECG paper we have the vertical lines as well as the horizontal lines. Horizontal line represent the time, whereas the vertical lines, it will denote the amplitude, right? Now this ECG paper, if you see properly closely, you can see that there is a heavy line every 5 millimeter in both the planes, over horizontal plane as well as in the vertical plane, right? Thus, there are small squares of 1 millimeter into 1 millimeter and the big square of 5 millimeter into 5 millimeter, right? So this small square over here, it represents, or it is 1 millimeter into 1 millimeter, whereas the big square is 5 millimeter into 5 millimeter, right? We will see its importance later. Now this ECG paper, it is a heat sensitive, it is plastic coated paper, and the graph is inscribed on this paper by the help of hot stylus. Okay, and the speed of the paper is 25 millimeter per second. In the standard speed, generally we maintain at 25 millimeter per second. So what does that mean? That means 25 millimeter of this paper is going through this ECG machine in 1 second, right? So the speed of the paper is 25 millimeter per second. That means 25 millimeter of paper is passing through this ECG machine in 1 second. That means 1 millimeter of the ECG paper will travel in 1/25, that is 0.04 second. Okay, so for the small box to travel in this ECG machine, it takes 0.04 second. Likewise, the big box, that is 5 millimeter, it takes 5/25, that is 0.2 second. This time is very important, because you have to see that how much time each wave took when they were passing through the ECG machine. Okay, so one small box takes 0.04 second to travel, and the big box, that is 5 millimeter, it takes 0.2 second, and the speed of the paper is 25 millimeter per second. So if you calculate, you'll find it out that small box is 0.04 second and the big box is 0.2 second. Okay, so that was about the ECG paper. Now let us talk about ECG leads. So I think you are familiar with the leads, how many leads we are using and what kind of leads we are using, right? So what are these leads actually? So these leads, they are the connector between the 2 points on the body surface and the electrocardiograph. So these leads, they are connecting our body surface and the electrocardiograph, right? And the lead consists of electrodes, which are the metal plates, and they also contain the lead wires, right? And I think you are aware of that we have bipolar leads, that is lead 1, lead 2, and lead 3. Then we have unipolar chest leads, B1, B2, B3, B4, B5, and B6. Then we have augmented unipolar leads. They are ABL, ABR and ABF. So you see, we are using 12 leads to record an ECG. But the question is, why do we need 12 leads to record the ECG? Well, we need 12 leads ECG to get a complete picture of the heart from different angles, right? So when we see the heart from the different angles, we have a complete picture of the heart, and it helps for the better interpretation of the heart function, also for the better localization of the heart problems. So because of that, we are using 12 leads. So you can see in this picture how this particular vehicle, it is being photographed from different angles. So because we are taking a photograph from different angles, and this is giving a complete picture of this particular vehicle. Likewise, even if we are doing with the heart, we are taking the picture of the heart from different angles so that we have the complete picture, and it helps us for the better interpretation of the heart function, right? Now, bipolar leads, these leads consist of two active electrodes, right? These two electrodes, they are placed on the surface of the body, and these measure the potential difference across the two electrodes. So we have again lead 1, lead 2 and lead 3, right? In lead 1, the negative terminal is connected to the right arm and the positive terminal is connected to the left arm. The positive terminal is the recording electrode, right? So the current is passing from the negative terminal to the positive terminal, right? And negative terminal is connected to the right arm and the positive terminal is connected to the left arm. Likewise, we have lead 2. In lead 2, you can see that negative terminal is connected to the right arm and the positive terminal is connected to the left leg. Now, this lead 2 is very, very important. It's also called as standard limb lead 2. You know why? It is because limb lead 2, it is used often for cardiac monitoring. Okay. So whenever we take ECG graph, there are many graphical representation occurring in each lead, right? But we have to focus on lead 2. Okay, because in lead 2, the positioning of the electrode, they most commonly resemble the pathway of current flow in the normal atrial and ventricular depolarization. That is why we take a lead 2 as the standard for cardiac monitoring. Why? As positioning of the electrode, most commonly they resemble the pathway of current flow in the normal atrial and ventricular depolarization. So we have to focus on lead 2 for cardiac monitoring, right? And we are placing negative terminal to the right arm and the positive terminal to the left leg. So you can see it is representing, or it is resembling the pathway of the current flow exactly that occurs during the atrial and ventricular depolarization. Lead 3, we have negative terminal connected to the left arm and the positive terminal connected to the left leg. That is the lead 3. Okay, now that is lead 1, lead 2 and lead 3. Now we have unipolar leads, which is also called as chest leads, and here it is called as unipolar leads because one electrode is active, other electrode it is indifferent. Now, in unipolar chest leads, we are going to place the leads in the intercostal space, right? Before telling where to place the leads, let us talk about what is intercostal space. So intercostal space, it is the anatomic space between the two ribs, right? This intercostal space are numbered for the rib superior to it, right? So intercostal space, they are the anatomic space between the two ribs, right? Now we have to locate the intercostal space. So how will you do that? So to locate the intercostal space, first what you do is you place the finger gently at the base of the throat, in the central position. You can just try it in your neck also, right? When as I say, you can just feel it in your body. Okay, so place the finger gently at the base of the throat, central position, and go down, right? And as you go down, you will feel the top of the sternum, right? And still you go further downward, then you will find one bony hump over here. And this bony hump is also called as angle of Lewis, or also called as sternal angle. And if you move your finger just next to it, you will find a space over there. And that space is the second intercostal space, right? So how are you going to do? You are placing your finger. You can place your index finger over here. Then you go in the center of your throat, center position, and you go down. As you go down, you will feel the top of the sternum. Then you still go further downward. Then you will find the bony hump over there. This bony hump is called as the angle of Lewis, or the sternal angle. And if you just go towards the side of this angle of Lewis, or the sternal angle, you will find a space over there. And this space is the second intercostal space. Then after that, you palpate the other rib and you will find a space over there. This is the third intercostal space. Then you will find the rib, and again you will find this space, which is the fourth intercostal space. Now, in the fourth intercostal space, you are going to place. So, fourth intercostal space is in the right as well as in the left. So, you are going to place the first chest lid, that is also called as B1, or somewhere it is written as C1, right? So, this B1 or C1, the first chest lid, you are going to place it on the right, fourth intercostal space, to the right of the sternum, right? And the second V2 or the C2, second lead, you are going to place it on the fourth intercostal space, left to the sternum. So C1 or V1 is in the right to the sternum. Fourth intercostal space, right of the sternum, is B1. And fourth intercostal space, left of the sternum, is the V2. Then directly you are going to place B4. So B4 is fifth intercostal space. So from the fourth, you are going to again feel the rib and the fifth intercostal space. In the fifth intercostal space, so this is the clavicle, right? In the mid clavicular line. Okay, so just draw the line over here, right? And in the middle of this clavicle is called as the mid clavicular line. So in the mid clavicular line, in the fifth intercostal space, you are going to place the fourth, or B4, or the fourth lead. And V3, you are going to place it the V2 and V4, right? Then B5 is in the fifth intercostal space, in the anterior axillary line. Again, this axillary line is divided into anterior axillary line, middle axillary line, and the posterior axillary line. So you are going to place in the fifth intercostal space, in the anterior axillary line, is the B5, and the fifth intercostal space at the mid axillary line is the sixth chest lead. So that is how we are going to place the chest leads. Okay, so I'll repeat again one more time. So B1 in the fourth intercostal space, right of the sternum, V2 in the fourth intercostal space, left of the sternum, B4 in the fifth intercostal space, mid clavicular line, B3 in between B2 and B4, B5 in the fifth intercostal space, anterior axillary line, and V6 in the fifth intercostal space, in the left mid axillary line. So this is how we are going to place the chest leads. Now we have the augmented leads, right? The voltage is augmented in these leads. That is why they are called as the augmented leads. And in these augmented leads, how we are going to do is, one lead is connected to the positive terminal, while the other two are connected in combination through electrical resistance to the negative terminal. It is all done when the ECG machine was manufactured, so we don't need to bother much. It is already set in the ECG machine. Okay, so we have again three different kind of augmented leads, that is ABR, ABL, and ABF, right? So we are using 12 ECG leads. The 6 limb leads, they can be thought as looking at the heart in the vertical plane. So the limb leads, that is lead 1, lead 2, lead 3, ABL, ABF and ABR, they are going to look the heart in the vertical plane, right? That is electrical activity moving up and down and left and right across the heart. That is looked by the limb leads, okay? So limb leads, they are looking the heart in the vertical plane. That is electrical activity going up and down or right and left. Whereas the chest leads, there are 6 chest leads, they are looking at the heart in a horizontal plane, right? That is the view of the electrical activity moving anteriorly and posteriorly, right? So that is why we are using the 12 lead ECG, which sees the heart from 12 different views, allowing a panoramic assessment of any disruption in the cardiac electrical activity. So that is how we are going to place the chest leads, and then we are also going to put the limb leads in the right arm, left leg and the right leg. So over here I want to show you one video so that it can give you a complete picture.
Hi there, I'm David, I'm one of the medical students. Thanks for coming in today. Can I just confirm your name and date of birth?
Sure, it's James Alexander, 13th of December, 1989.
Okay, James, I'd like to do an ECG today. It's an electrical tracing of your heart. It's going to involve me placing some sticky pads on your chest, arms and legs and measuring the electrical activity of your heart. Would that be okay?
Yeah, that sounds fine.
For all this, I'm going to need you to take your top off and just lie down on the couch for me. Is that okay? Are you comfortable where you are?
Yes, sir.
Do you have any pain in your chest at all?
No.
Okay, I'm just going to start by feeling on your chest to work out where to put these leads. Okay. I'm just going to place some sticky pads on. So if you just relax your hands flat for me, just on the side, that's great, thank you. I'm just going to put some sticky pads on your wrist. And on your ankles as well. Okay, that's done. Thank you very much, James. I'm just going to take the leads off.
Yes, so that was about ECG taking, how we place the electrodes in the different areas, and then with the help of ECG machine, the electrocardiogram was taken out, right? And we saw that in each lead, we have different waves formed over there. And as I told you earlier, we have to focus on lead 2 for the cardiac monitoring, right? Now, I think we have already discussed what kind of waves are being formed over there. So we have the P wave, we have the QRS wave, and we have the Q wave, right? So this is the person over here, and here this graphical representation is mainly of lead 2, because if you see in other leads, the graphical representation may not be like this. There will be alteration in the graphical representation, but we are not going to discuss all those detail over here today. We are just going to discuss what will happen to the leads, or what will happen to the ECG wave at the limb lead 2. So this is the lead 2 which we are focusing on today. So you can see over here P wave. So as we have discussed earlier, what is the cause for P wave? It is because SA node, it is firing, right? So when SA node fires, the wave of depolarization, right? It wave of depolarization is produced, and this will go downward and leftward towards the AV node, is it not? So here, look at this. This lead 2, we have negative terminal over here and the positive terminal in the lead. So the current is flowing from the negative to the positive side, right? And if you see the P wave, it is because of the SA node firing and the wave of depolarization produced, which is going downward and leftward. So as the wave of depolarization is going downward, right? So from negative to positive side, so this will give you the positive deflection, that is the P wave. So P wave represents the atrial depolarization, right? Now as the depolarization wave goes through the AV node, many of these wave of depolarization, they will die out as they hit over this fibrous annulus over here. Only some amount of depolarizing current is able to pass through the electrical window of the AV node, right? So only few of the depolarizing current will be able to pass through the AV node, but most of the depolarizing current which hits on this fibrous annulus, they will die out. So at the AV node, very small vector is produced which is not sensed by the electrodes. So ECG fails to pick up this vector, and because of that you will see the isoelectric line, which is the PQ segment. So what is the cause for PQ segment? It is a pause when the depolarizing current is passing through the AV node, and this wave of depolarization is so minimum that it is not taken up by the ECG machine, and that will give you a isoelectric line, that is a PQ segment, right? Now after the wave of depolarization goes through the ventricular side, ventricles, right? So the ventricular depolarization starts, right? So when the ventricular depolarization starts, it happens in three phases, if you are aware of that. First, there will be septal depolarization. First one to get depolarized is the septum, right? Then there will be major ventricular depolarization, that is most of the ventricles mass, they are going to get depolarized, and the depolarizing current moves from the deeper myocardium to the outer myocardium, right? And the last one to get depolarized is the basal side of the ventricles, right? So that's why we have this QRS complex. So Q, it represents the septal depolarization. So in the septal depolarization, we can see that the wave of depolarization, it is going from the left to right, right? And because of that, we get this negative deflection over here, okay? So negative deflection of the Q wave, it is because of the septal depolarization where the current is passing from the left to right or from down to up. That is giving the negative deflection, Q wave. So Q wave, if you talk about Q wave is the septal depolarization. And now, as I told you earlier, there will be major ventricular depolarization. That is depolarizing current now from the septum, they are going to the deeper myocardium, and from the deeper myocardium, the wave of depolarization or the current moves from the deeper myocardium to the outer myocardium. So current is traveling from is traveling downward and outward, right? So because of that, again we get a and this current flow in the ventricles is very forceful or very strong. Because of that, we get a very positive deflection. This is the R wave. So R wave represents the major ventricular depolarization. Since the ventricle is large enough and since the depolarizing current is strong enough in the ventricles, the depolarization will be strong enough and that will lead to strong positive deflection, that is the R wave, right? And as I told you, the last one to get depolarized is the basal part of the ventricles. So because the ventricles and the basal part, in the basal part, the current is again flowing from the down to up. So because of that, there will be negative deflection created. That is the S wave. Okay, so S wave represents the it represents the basal part of the ventricular depolarization. Now as the whole ventricles have got depolarized, there will be slightly pause at that moment, and that will give you this ST segment. So the ST segment is an isoelectric line where there is no electrical activity occurring. So because of that, there will be again isoelectric line. This is the ST segment. Then after a few milliseconds, there will be repolarizing current starting, right? Now this ventricular depolarization starts like the part that depolarized last will repolarize first from the outer to the inner myocardium, and that will give you a positive deflection, which is the T wave. So this is how the PQRST wave is being formed in the lead 2, right? So we have P wave representing atrial depolarization, Q wave representing the septal depolarization, R wave representing the major ventricular depolarization, S wave representing the basal depolarization, or as a whole you can say that QRS complex represents the ventricular depolarization. Then we have ST segment, which represents the pause after depolarization, and T wave, it represents the ventricular depolarization. So this is how the wave is been formed in the ECG tracing. Okay, this is just for a small information how these small boxes are important. I told you earlier that the speed of this paper is 25 millimeter per second. That means 1 millimeter of the paper, that is one small box, takes 0.04 seconds for it to travel. That means now we can calculate the time, how much each wave took to pass through that ECG machine. For example, I'll just give you one example, like P wave. So P wave took 2.5 box. That means, as I told you, one box is 0.04 second, right? So 0.04 second plus 0.04 second plus half, that is 0.02. That will be 0.1 second. So like that, these boxes are important so that we can count or so that we can measure how much each wave took to pass, right? And when you become a physician or a cardiologist, by looking at the ECG itself, you will be coming to know that the P wave is like taking longer duration or the PQ segment is taking longer duration. You don't need to calculate at all. But as now, as a student, we have to calculate how much P wave took by calculating the time frame. All right. Now we have different waves, different segments and different intervals. So wave, they are produced due to deflection of the needle. Segment, they are isoelectric line drawn when the electrode don't sense any type of electrical activity. And interval means summation of wave or a wave and a segment. So it's a combination of wave or a wave and a wave and segment. So P wave, actual depolarization, Q wave representing the depolarization of the interventricular septum, R wave representing excitation of the major ventricles, S wave representing the basal part of the ventricular depolarization, QRS as a whole represents ventricular depolarization, T wave representing the ventricular repolarization, and U wave, it is rarely seen, but it is due to slow depolarization of the papillary muscles. Segment, it is a straight line connecting two waves. So you have always look PR segment, follow P wave, the brief isoelectric period, right? And ST segment, it is of very much importance during the myocardial infarction, which represents end of S wave to the beginning of T wave. I think you just go through all this because we don't have much time to discuss all those things over here. Then interval, it comprises of at least one wave plus the connecting straight line. So PR interval means interval from beginning of P wave to the beginning of Q wave. And this PR interval is very much important when you talk about the heart block, right? So as a whole, this is the ECG graph or ECG tracing which you will be getting, and you have to know how to draw this ECG graph, right? So we have P wave, QRS, and we have the T wave. Now let us talk about ECG interpretation, how we interpret ECG. I'm not going to go again in very detail, just whatever you need to know as an undergraduate, just that much, okay? So let us talk about ECG interpretation. So as I told you earlier, we have different leads, and in different leads we have different waveform. So if you see lead 1, lead AVR, lead B1, lead P4, look at this wave. You will not identify QRS itself. In fact, this QRS, they are inverted in shape. So it is again depending upon the electrical activity occurring in each lead. So the base thing what you can do is you just follow lead 2, because in lead 2, whatever, however you have studied, it will be there because it is following the normal pathway of the heart. So focus on the lead 2 whenever you are talking or whenever you are interpreting the ECG wave for now. Now whenever you see ECG graph, you have to look for the rhythm. Now what do you mean by rhythm? Normal sinus rhythm means each P wave is followed by a QRS wave. If each P wave is followed by a QRS wave, we say it as a normal sinus rhythm. Okay, and you have to look for that. That is, each P wave, when it is followed by the QRS, always it is called as a normal sinus rhythm. You must have observed in the heart block, right? Sometimes there is absent of QRS. There is two wave, two P wave, and there is QRS. So it is not following the normal sinus rhythm. So it is an irregular sinus rhythm in the heart block because each P wave is not followed by QRS. Sometimes two P wave is followed by the one QRS. Sometimes three P wave is followed by one QRS. So it is not a normal sinus rhythm in the heart block. Okay. So you say it as normal sinus rhythm whenever each P wave is followed by the QRS wave. Okay. And now second thing what you have to see is heart rate. So you can calculate the heart rate from the ECG graph. So heart rate, the normal heart rate is 60 to 100 beats per minute, right? And if it is less than 60 beats per minute, it is called as sinus bradycardia. And if it is more than 100, it is called as sinus tachycardia, right? Now, how will you calculate the heart rate by looking at the ECG graph or ECG paper? So as I told you earlier, right, speed of the paper is 25 millimeter per second. That means in 1 second, same thing, in 1 second, 25 millimeter of paper is running through the ECG machine. That means in 60 seconds, how much ECG paper is running? That is 25 into 60. That will come around 1500. So 1500 millimeter means 1500 small boxes are passing through the ECG machine in 1 minute. Or 60 seconds, or else you can say that 300 big boxes, because you know one big box contain five small box. That means 1500 small boxes means there is 300 big boxes, right? So in 1 minute, either 1500 small boxes are passing or 300 big boxes are passing. Therefore, 1 minute will be represented by 1500 small divisions or 300 big division. Now, how will you calculate by this? So the heart rate can be calculated by counting the number of either small or a big division between the two subsequent R waves. So we have to either calculate the small boxes or we have to count the big boxes between the two R waves, right? And generally you will take the lead two only. Okay, so now how will you calculate? Heart rate is equal to 1500 divided by number of small boxes between the two R waves, or you can calculate by 300 by number of big boxes between the two R waves. Generally big boxes will not be like definitive. Because of that, we have to count the small boxes. Okay, and how do we do it? Heart rate is equal to 1500 divided by number of horizontal small divisions or small boxes between the two subsequent R waves. Now look at this example. We have R wave and R wave over here. Now we have to count how many small boxes are over here. So you can just count here. Look at this. It is starting at this thick line over here, and it is ending just after one thick line over here. So there are how many big boxes? 1, 2, 3, 4 big boxes. That means how many small boxes are there? 4 into 5, 20 small boxes, and one more small box is over here. That means 21 small box is between this R to this R wave. Now, so number of small boxes is 21 between these two R wave. Now heart rate is equal to 1500 divided by 21. It will give 71 beats per minute. So this is how we'll calculate the heart rate. Okay. So calculation of heart rate is by counting the small boxes between the two R wave, then 1500 divided by number of small boxes will give you the heart rate. Okay. So if the rate is slower, then we call it as bradycardia. And if this wave formed is at the faster rate, more than 100, then it is called as the sinus tachycardia. Likewise, we have this ventricular tachycardia and ventricular fibrillation. In ventricular tachycardia, generally the QRS complex, they are highly polymorphic. Okay, and in ventricular fibrillation, the ECG shows irregular, extremely small or extremely fast small potential fluctuation in rate, rhythm, amplitude and appearance. So ventricular fibrillation, like it's like the heart is getting the wave of depolarization is so fast that the heart is not getting proper time for the getting depolarized. Because of that, we have this irregular, extremely fast small potential fluctuation in the rate, rhythm, both, even in amplitude also. Okay. Now talking about heart block, you know it, disturbances in the normal transmission of impulse. There can be sinoatrial nodal block or atrioventricular block. Whenever there is sinoatrial nodal block, neither atrial or ventricular contraction occur. Whole heartbeat is lost for 1 or 2 cycles. After approximately 2 cardiac cycles, heart will resume its normal action as a new pacemaker other than SAN, sinoatrial node will take over. So it is not a problem. Now, atrial ventricular nodal block, it can be again divided into first degree heart block, second degree heart block, and the third degree heart block. Now, what do you understand by this first degree heart block, second degree heart block, and the third degree heart block? I'll just show you in the ECG over here. So in first degree heart block, what is happening? There is a P wave, there is QRS wave, right? So generally in first degree heart block, all atrial impulses reach the ventricle, but PR interval will be slightly or abnormally long. So atrial rate to the ventricular rate is generally 1 to 1, okay? in first degree AB block, all the atrial impulses which is been generated in the SN node, it will reach the ventricle, but the PR interval will be abnormally long. So the atrial to the ventricular rate will be 1:1. And in second degree heart block, again we have Mobitz 1 and Mobitz 2 type. The difference between Mobitz 1 and Mobitz 2 is that the PR interval, generally in Mobitz type 1, the PR interval lengthens progressively until a ventricular beat is lost. So you can see over there, PR interval is lengthened over here, and one ventricular beat will be lost. Okay. So in PR in Mobitz type 1, PR interval lengthens progressively until a ventricular beat is dropped. That is 2:1. So there will be two wave and one QRS complex. In Mobitz type 2, there will be three P wave and one QRS complex. So this picture is a little bit not clear, but you have to understand that in Mobitz 1, it is 2:1 ratio. Well, let us talk about first degree. It is 1:1, that is one P wave and one QRS wave. There is 1:1 ratio. Here, in Mobitz 1, there is 2:1 ratio, that is two P wave and one QRS. In Mobitz 2, we have 3:1 ratio, three P wave and one QRS complex. And in complete heart block or a third degree heart block, there is complete interruption of conduction between atria and ventricles, right? Last but not the least, we have this acute MI. In acute MI, there will be elevation of the ST segment in the leads overlying the area of impact, and there will be depression of the ST segment in the reciprocal leads. So whenever we are asked about the what is the diagnostic criteria for MI in ECG, it will be always ST segment elevation in the leads overlying the area of impact, right? So this was brief description about ECG, and you have to see it in the subject to understand further. So once you come back, we will have ECG practical, and I think that will make you more clear. So this much for today. I hope you have understood to some extent. Thank you. Let me take your attendance. Okay?